Why are some people more concerned about the natural environment than others? Does a simulated view of nature have the same restorative benefits as a real view? Do natural disasters like storms and droughts affect mental health and well-being? These are all questions about psychology and nature, and all are studied by psychologists. Now, when I say nature, I mean nature as the outdoors, as natural processes from your backyard to the biosphere. I also mean a spectrum from domestic nature, such as plants in your home, to nearby nature, such as parks and gardens, to managed nature, such as tree farms and agricultural areas, to wild nature, native plants and animals, wilderness areas that are remote, challenging, or purposely left undeveloped, and even wild processes in your own body. And I also mean nature and the natural world as concepts, as social or cultural constructions that often mean different things to different people. When I say psychology, I mean the study of mind, emotions, and behavior, the science of mental life, and in a deeper sense, psyche logos, the language of the psyche. Questions about psychology and nature, like the ones I posed, can be approached from various areas of psychology you may be familiar with. For example, we can use social psychology to help determine why some people are more concerned about the natural environment than others. An obligation to care about nature or to take pro-environmental actions stems from an interaction of someone's basic values, their experiences, their beliefs about the world, and their sense of empowerment. We can use neuropsychology to track the influence of green spaces on the human brain and nervous system. Simulated views of nature do have psychological and physiological benefits, but not as much as real views. Again and again, research shows that contact with real nature is more stress-reducing and better at sharpening our attention. Natural disasters don't just affect physical property. Clinical psychology reveals that these events have strong negative impacts on the mental health and well-being of people, families, and communities, including increased rates of anxiety and suicide. Some psychologists specialize in these psychology and nature questions. For 50 years, researchers in the field of environmental psychology have studied people's relationship with built environments such as buildings and neighborhoods, and natural environments including parks and wilderness areas. They have determined what makes some neighborhoods or landscapes more satisfying and easy to navigate than others, and ways to categorize the feelings of awe you experience in a place like Grand Canyon or in a Gothic cathedral. Conservation psychology is an interdisciplinary area in which psychologists partner with other experts, such as conservation biologists or sustainability professionals, to address human factors related to the conservation of wildlife and resources, like how emotional connections made with captive animals in zoos can lead to efforts to protect them in the wild, or why some energy conservation programs work and others backfire. Some psychologists take a more holistic approach. Ecopsychology focuses on our interdependence and interbeing with the rest of the natural world, and how this influences people's identity, their sense of being connected to something larger than themselves, and the pain they may feel about issues such as species extinction. For example, how do you avoid becoming depressed or just tuned out about issues like toxins in the environment? Or can going outside and working with animals make mental health therapy more effective? Doing environmental psychology may also mean taking a hard look at the field of psychology itself and how the Western conception of mind as separate from nature may actually distance people from the natural world and contribute to the development of environmental problems.